this, but you really are in rare air. And I mean that sincerely. This is a very, very talented and dynamic. You'll hear lots of interesting stories. I've had the pleasure over the years of I hope you relate a story. I'm going to have to go because my girls are dancing, but I hope you relate this story. And
yes, I do remember. Okay, I'll...
Yeah, but you may not tell it right, but anyway.
I haven't got it in my notes. It's something I forgot.
I might come in later and I'll check. So save that one for later if it's in your notes. Okay. So Elizabeth has been, what has she been doing? She's been teaching for God knows how many years, 75 years. She's been dancing. She held the longest gig at Arrest Days or something in the history of the...
In Cosmos in White Rock.
In Cosmos in White Rock.
15 years.
She had the gig at Arrest Days for many, many years. There's stories that she's going to tell you that you're just going to go, what, right? This is not old school belly dance. This is the school of belly dance right here. There's no question about that. I wish there were a lot more new people that were in this, in here today and listening. I had the real pleasure of witnessing my hero receive a wonderful, wonderful award this year. I think it was November in Surrey. Elizabeth is a received the, she's a treasure, a civic treasure in Surrey. Big medal, honking big medal. It happens, thank God, to Elizabeth, and this is for some of the, for her visual art work and her contribution to the community that she lives in. So this is a Renaissance woman. I'm going to take up your whole hour. This is a Renaissance woman. This is rare air. This is Elizabeth. I love her with my heart. I have to go check.
Now retired, obviously. I still dance at old folks' home when they, you know, don't mind somebody that totters around. I'm 77 years old. I got hooked on dance in general when I was 4. I took ballet, and I used to wear the whole pink thing, you know. And whenever my father used to come home from the office, he knew as soon as he opened the door, he had to throw down his briefcase because I would listen for the door, and I would come running up and do the flying arabesque into his arms. I better darn well catch him for quite a while. Then I gave up all dancing, and many years later, I decided, I guess I was 28 or so, that I needed to have some physical exercise. Remember, those days, when I was 28, 50 years ago, there was no aerobics. There was no physical exercise being offered to women. So I decided to pick up ballet again. And then I realized that ballet was not for me, because ballet was about somebody else's vision, somebody else's choreography, and I just wanted to express myself. So then I tried flamenco. Well, that was great. It was very expressive, it was sexy, it was dynamic. But then I got flat feet and shin splints. So okay, that was out. Then my friend said, let's try belly dancing. And I said, no way. He said, oh, come on, we can do it for 8 weeks. We can. And I was hooked. And that was it. That was all these years ago. I was hooked on belly dancing. Took many courses, lots of different teachers, lots of workshops, blah, blah, blah. It's great. I got to tell you, this was the 1970s. This was the YMCA in Burrard where I took my first belly dance lesson. My first costume was, in the 70s, it was brown. Brown cotton, a hemp, crocheted vest, wooden beads, no metal. I mean, very 70s, right? Then I saw my first real belly dancer. Her name was Cosima, and she was with some Bellingham troupe. And she was a very large woman, but the way she danced, she was like an angel. And I thought, yes, this is what I want to do. And so that was the start of my belly dance lessons and career. It was great. Went to Egypt with Gail Haddad, Rahma, and we took Gawazi lessons, that, you know, these guys. And they cost an arm and a leg, but it was worth it. We learned a lot from them, and actually, we went back 2 years later, after the fundamentalists had taken hold, and went back to try and hire them again to teach us more. And they said, I'm sorry, we can't go because the fundamentalists have shut us down, but they remembered us. And they said, look, you guys are from Canada, we've taught you everything we know. When this all clears up, we want you to come back to Egypt and reteach us this dance. So I thought, oh, that's great. My first professional gig was at a place called Oriana on 10th Avenue in West Point Grey. It was close to where I lived. My husband and I, was in the pouring rain. We were coming home with, didn't have a car, bags of groceries that were, you know, kind of melting in the rain, and I had my scarf on, miserable. I had my painting pants on. And this guy, I guess the manager, was in front of this little restaurant sweeping out the front porch. So my husband says, pushes me through the door, and he says, go ask for a job. Because it said opening, grand opening tonight for this little Greek restaurant. So I stumbled through the door, and he says, what? I says, do you need a belly dancer for your opening night? He says, yeah. But who? I said, me, but I don't always look like this. Well, he was not convinced. Come at 7, he says. So threw the groceries down, took the bus, went to Dresso. You know, Dresso.
Yes.
I didn't have a costume, not really, at this brown thing. So, okay, so what I did is I got my 1970s flare pants, right? Tied them up to make kind of harem pants. I got a red t-shirt, cut it off here, strung an elastic on it, glued sequins all over it here and there, got some tassels, but I didn't have time to, you know, make tassels, so I just strung them down. It was a pretty homemade costume. And then, okay, I got there at 7. He said, sit down. So I sit there, and of course, that was my first lesson. They wanted to come early so that they could say to their customers, we've got a belly dancer, and there she is, she's sitting down. So endless cups of coffee, my stomach is going acid. He says, wait, I says, come on. You said to come at 7. He says, yeah, wait. For those of you that dance in restaurants, you know that this is the typical routine. So 8 o'clock comes around, he says, go now. I don't know, you know, go now. So, okay, where do I change? I need to prep, right? Headdress, blah, blah, blah. In there, so it's, what is it? It's a wine closet. So I'm there with the bottles, trying to get my little mirror organized. Finally, I hear my music. My music is starting, and I'm not ready. So my stomach is acid, I'm totally stressed out. I'm rushing to the ladies room to throw up. You know, the introduction's over. So kind of wash up a bit and sail out into the dance floor. So I danced for 20 minutes. I don't remember a thing about it except that I didn't fall over. And at the end of it, I kind of put my cover up on and scurry out, kind of. He says, wait, come back tomorrow. Okay, so I got a job. That was my first job. At that time, they paid us $7.50 for a 20-minute dance. So now it's gone up quite a bit, but that's what it was. At that time, we did a lot of sharing of gigs. Belly dancing was just new. The first person that actually had belly dancing in Vancouver was, at that time, was called Orestes. Now, do any of you remember Orestes?
Yeah.
A guy from Greece called Aristides decided to spark up his clientele that he was going to have belly dancing every single day of the week. And man, he had lineups outside the door at first. Everybody wanted to know who and what was belly dancing. So then everybody else, all the other Greek restaurants, jumped on board and had belly dancing, which was really unusual because belly dancing really is not a Greek thing. Greek dancing is all in black and they kind of waft around ever so delicately, right? This was belly dancing. So everybody, all the other Greeks thought this is a great thing, let's also hire a belly dancer. So there was a lot of jobs. It was really great, that was a great time. We shared gigs a lot because we didn't know any better, or maybe it was a kind of a very kind community. Somebody would blow into town and say, I'd like to dance in a restaurant. And somebody would say, yeah, okay, you take my place. And we just step back and we watch and let that person dance and get paid. And we shared jobs around a lot very, very easily. Until some people came from out of town, from the East, and kind of grabbed the jobs and wouldn't share. So that kind of taught us all, the local dancers, a lesson. Okay, this is my job, I'm going to hang on to it. It's really too bad, because now we're just hanging on to our own jobs and not allowing others, you know, to come in. Then, how many of you know Farida? Kathy Balk? Okay. She was one of my teachers, and she decided with her, she had access to three musicians, a drummer, a wind instrument person, and a canoe player. So the three of them and three dancers decided to go on the road, one night stands all over up and down Vancouver Island. So I was all over it. Colleen O'Neill was the other dancer. So the three of us, three dancers and three musicians, went on the road. And okay, so we're driving up, this is really, really late at night, we're off the ferry, we're going past Parksville somewhere, I don't even know where. I was driving my little car with two people. They had a van with all their instruments, and they're driving through the rain and dark and wind, and they're driving, and I'm following the van. It's an old Volkswagen van, and I can, you know, down the road and off and on, and finally, I thought, oh, come on, let's get there. Finally, they turn up this driveway up. And I think, oh, thank God. So we turn up the driveway behind them, open the doors. It's the wrong van. Panic. So we back out of the driveway. I don't know where they are. Drive slowly up the road. There they are around the next corner. They were watching. Thank you a lot. They were watching for us. So we carried on. Our first gig was Malaspina College. And they were so excited to have this troupe of belly dancers do this program, that when we walked in, we had 2 hours before showtime. We were cutting it fine all over. They said, oh, we're waiting for you, we're waiting for you. We're so excited. We painted the stage for you, especially. Oh. Okay, let me see the stage. It's got puddles of wet paint, and it's black. So, okay, is it going to dry in 2 hours? I don't know, right? I had special paint for the stage. So we're getting ready just before curtain time. Colleen says, it's still shiny. So we said, okay, get some chalk. They can't see it from the audience. We'll chalk around the puddles so that we don't step in them. And then we'll dance around the puddles, even though the choreography is going to be all screwed up. We're not going to step in this way. I said, well, that's fine. Because I'm the opening act, and I'm the moon goddess, and I had my silver costume on, and I was supposed to throw silver stars. I said, what am I going to do? It's going to stick. So we decided, hey, it's not our problem. This is the choreography. You sprinkle stars. We'll deal with it later. So there I go, sprinkling stars, and I'm sure to this day this. Stars under the paint. Then, okay, that was my little disaster. Then Colleen comes on, and she's got this gorgeous, very expensive, fragile belt. And she kind of does floor work, and then she lies down, and poof, her belt pops open. And what to do? Disaster, costume meltdown. So, so she's a trooper. She just ignores the belt. And somebody says, kick it to me. She says, no, there's a wet patch there. So she had to dance around the belt and around all the wet patches. She did a great job. Then we saw all the other small towns we went to. I don't even know their names. We rolled in 2 hours before showtime. What do we have to do? We have to sweep the floor. We have to set up the chairs. We have to take tickets. And then they wanted us to stack the chair. There's no stack the chair. We were pooped by the time the performance was started. I'm telling you, it was a really kind of a once-in-a-lifetime thing. I'll never go on the road again. That was we were militant, because this was really early days of belly dancing, and we were really something. So so we were billeted with various other belly dancers and students all over up and down the island, right? So in one case, it was still pouring rain, wind blowing. We were billeted in this person's house. She was so excited. So at 11 o'clock at night, we roll up after the performance, right? Here, this is where you're sleeping. Right. Her house was under renovation. It was a room about this size with a ceiling but no walls. Okay, and the wind is blowing in, the wind is blowing out. So we've got our sleeping bags, so we're all huddled, sort of in the middle. You know, you never know when the wind's gonna change. And oh, none of us got any sleep. Armando, the drummer, snored like it was just terrible. We all got up and we were all stiff and cold. There was no heat, right? It's moist. Anyway, vanquish that. Right, so then I decided to go to Egypt. I made enough money belly dancing that I decided I wanted a real Egyptian costume. So went to Egypt with a few other belly dancers, and we had heard of Madame Abla. Who has heard of Madame Abla? Her costumes are famous. So we went, does anybody have a Madame Abla costume? Good for you. Did you buy it in Cairo?
From a wholesaler through Cairo, yes.
Okay. We went to Madame Abla's. Okay. We didn't know where she was. We just had an address and Madame Abla. So we took a taxi. We said, Madame Abla. He looked down and he says, yeah, he didn't speak English. So we're driving through Cairo, all the back streets and alleys, and we're getting lost. We said, okay, we're going into my street over here. We don't know where we are. It's three of us. Where is Madame Abla? So he goes up this alley and then he stops and he says, that way. So we get out. Okay, we walk up this alley. It's too narrow for the taxi. There's chickens feeding on the side of the road. There's garbage and little kids with their noses. And we're walking along and saying, green door. It says, green door. Okay, finally down in the middle of the alley, we see this green door. It's a huge working door with a, you know, a little tiny peephole. So bam, bam, bam on the door. We don't even know what the right place. Bam, bam, bam. The peephole opens. What? Madame, okay, fine. Out opens the door, there's a young man. He says, up, three. So three flights, right? So we're trudging along, there's no light. The lights are all burned out. We're in the dark, in the middle of Cairo. God knows what's happening. Anyway, we're all hanging on to each other for dear life, trudging up. There's another door at the top of the, bam, bam, bam. Open the door, there's, must be Madame Abla, because she's a big woman, dressed in a very gray, boring abaya, big woman, kind of middle-aged, Madame Abla. Yes, she says, come in. So we go in through her workshop. There are six girls beading. There's beads everywhere, sequins and fabric. It's like Aladdin's cave. It's great. They're all busy beading. She says, "You, what do you want?" We said, costumes, costumes. Okay, come this way. So she leads us to this room, opens the door, and it's like the Palace of Versailles. It's all white and gold, mirrors on the ceiling, columns, Greek columns here, gold, white leather couches, lovely big table, all sort of rococo and God knows what. So we're sitting there and she brings out these albums. She says, choose. So I had something really in my head that I wanted a white costume with really long fringe and stars here and stars here. And so I drew out this costume and I said, that's what I want, white, white and silver. Okay, fine. So we came, went into the fitting room one by one. So it was my turn. She came up to me and she went. And she went. She was illiterate. So just in her head, she didn't take any measurements. She just went. And I said, I thought, is that all? Yeah, go. Come back in a week. $100. So we went back in a week. She brought out my costume. It didn't have any stars. It was white and silver. Didn't have any stars anywhere. The fringe was not long. It was sort of medium length, but like a double fringe. And I kind of was really disappointed because I'd already paid. But whenever I danced in that costume, everybody said, you danced so well because the costume danced. She knew what she was doing. I realized, stars, I'm too small for all the stars all over that I wanted, because I wanted stars to kind of stick up here and stick up there. She knew what she was doing. No stars, she said. I can give you stars, you can put them on. No stars. So, really, she knew what she was doing. How are we doing? Oh my goodness. Okay, then, excuse me, my nose exploded. When I get excited, my nose explodes. Please cut that off. Then, I and another dancer, we were honored guests at a Sikh wedding, really traditional Sikh wedding. Now, because we represented fertility to the bridegroom. So we were honored guests. Actually, we were billeted with the bride's parents. We had a room to ourselves. The food was to die for. It was all homemade food, you know, cooked by grannies. Oh, it was great. And then during the wedding ceremony, we sat right beside the bride. There was us, the bride, and then the groom. So we watched the whole traditional ceremony. It was fascinating. All of the different things they did, they walked around the fire. We had to walk around the fire with them 3 times. I don't know what that meant. But anyway, it was a beautiful ceremony. And then they paid us handsomely. We were there for 3 days, just filling our faces with this wonderful food. And then a year later, they called us back to dance for their firstborn. So it worked. Then in 1981, I was sitting there in the garden. It was August, it was hot. I got a phone call from one of the restaurants where I was dancing, and they said, can you dance tonight and stay overnight? I said, yeah, sure, whatever. What is it? He said, there's a bunch of rock groups that are going to Edmonton, and they want a belly dancer on the plane to amuse them. They're going to Edmonton from Vancouver. And you're going to be billeted in Edmonton, and then you can come back, or you can carry on with them to Chicago, because this was Vancouver-Edmonton-Chicago tour. So I said, oh yeah, sure. So these are the people I danced for. See whether you know them, because at the time, I was so ignorant. I was not interested in rock music, so I didn't know who they were, but now I know who they are. Ted Nugent. Oh yeah? Guy, right?
Yes.
Okay, I sat beside him on the plane and chatted with him. And he was so lovely, a lovely man. And then he turned away and looked out the window, and I asked him a direct question, and he ignored me. Then he turned and he saw the look on my face, and he said, did you ask me something? I said, yeah. He said, I'm deaf. He said, I am stone deaf. I said, well, how can you perform? I mean, you sing and jump around, how can you perform? He says, I just perform. He says, my band follows me. He says, I can do anything I want, they have to keep up. So that's stardom, man. Then there was the Blue Oyster Cult, Rocket, I have to read these because I don't know. Heart, there were two women, isn't that reading?
Yeah.
Heart and Lover Boy. Okay, so these are somebody you've heard of.
Okay.
It was at the Commonwealth Stadium in Edmonton, and we had backstage. Oh, this is a great story. How much do you want? I said, 5 rock groups? They probably got a lot of money. I said, I want $500. This is when we were being paid $15 an hour. They said, oh, sure. Or their manager, their agent. I said, I thought I'd push my luck. I said, plus I want somebody to, as a dresser. I didn't want to go alone there, you know? I wanted my friend beside me. She was not really a dancer. So I said, I want a dresser. No problem, how much for her? I said, 200. Okay, no problem. So this was a king's ransom, you know? So there we were. I danced twice up and down the aisles. $700, no problem. So we landed in Edmonton, and we were at the Hilton. Well, the Hyatt, I can't remember, I think it was the Hyatt. And we're sort of standing there looking, what the hell do we do now? Because all the rockers are doing this and that. It's quite late at night, because the concert is the next day. And the manager or the agent comes along and he says, girls!
Girls.
Girls! Are you hungry? You want to eat? There's a restaurant there. And we said, yeah. And he says, and you want breakfast tomorrow, right? This. You have to buy everything at the Hyatt. We thought, okay, there goes our cash. He says, how much do you need? He holds up this roll. In their 20s, and he goes, and we're both looking. Talk, right? Oh, you 120 would have been plenty. So he puts out about 120 bucks. And then we said, no, that's enough. Oh, okay. So he hands us over and he was waiting for us to stop. So we came away with 120 bucks, went to the local cafe, spent $3 on breakfast. That's right. Always looking. So that was one of my big deals there. Wow. Another big deal, these are my highlights. I have many, many highlights, but these are sort of top of the mountain highlights. I was touring through Turkey, watching belly dancing, just to expand my knowledge. And I got an invitation, a handwritten invitation from somebody or other, I don't know. And I said, what's this? So somebody who could read Turkish says, oh, that's the manager of the Turkish Olympic wrestling team. They want you to dance for them privately. I thought, okay. Who else is going to be there? Oh, well, their wives and girlfriends. I thought, okay. So it was all arranged again. Minimum costume, right? I bought some stuff in Turkey, but not enough. So I did what I could. It's always good to do what you can because then you don't have any expectations for yourself. And you can't take yourself seriously because, like, really? And that's the best way to look at it. Don't have any expectations and don't take yourself seriously. That's been my mantra throughout my life. So, okay, they're all there. And damn it if they didn't set up a stage for me. They had risers and they had cloth and they had somebody to announce me. And I'm coming on as homemade costume and I'm dancing for them. And they thought it was fantastic because it was different, right? I was a huge hit. It was great. Got a whole bunch of love notes afterwards. I couldn't read because they were all in Turkish. I assume they were love notes. I left them behind. Or maybe they were propositions. I don't know. I didn't go into it. Another little highlight was I danced it for Expo 89. Was it 89?
86.
86. Okay. 86, okay, so that was harsh, because I danced four nights a week. I finished work at SFU, I was a graphic designer, finished work at 5, rushed to Expo site from SFU, jumped into my costume and danced for 15 minutes at 6 o'clock, for another 15, for 7 o'clock, at 8 o'clock, so 4 15-minute routines, which was harsh, because for that 45 minutes between, you're cooling off, and you really don't want to dance again. So that was a very professional experience for me. I had to get up the energy, I had to pretend that I was really enjoying this for the fourth time that evening. It was hard, and I'll never do that again either. It's a place called Zorba's. I don't know whether you remember this. Then I was asked to dance for G.F. Strong. And it's a good thing that I kind of asked the person who arranged it. I said, who am I dancing for? That's always a really good question to ask. Turns out I was dancing for a bunch of blind guys. I mean, hello? So I thought, okay, what a blind guy. All right, so I put lots of perfume on so that when I wafted along, they could smell me. I had Zills. I had a veil. I mean, I didn't care. What difference did it make? What kind of costume you had? But the nurses were there, so yeah, I made the effort. So what I did was I came up to each one and I played the Zills ever so gently in their ear. I touched them. I kind of said hello to each of the blind guys. You know, my name's Elizabeth, blah, blah, blah. So I made a good deal of it. You know, I did the best I could. I wafted my veil over top of them so they could feel the wind. And yeah, I don't know why they asked my belly is from blind people, but anyway, that's what it was. Then I was dancing at Cosmos in White Rock for many years, 15 years. And during one of those evenings, it was always a Friday night. Sometimes they were really busy, and other times, with the restaurant business, you never know. Oh, we don't know. So this time I came in and the restaurant was practically empty. I think there were two tables. So I sat there, and John, the owner, was always really good to me. I mean, I was a fixture there. So he said, come sit down, let's eat, and then you can go home. He said, you'll have something for it. Because you didn't dance, you didn't get paid. Not really fair, because you didn't turn up. So anyway, so I'm there in the middle of my little chicken dinner, and in comes this frazzled guy. Where's the manager? So right here. What? I've got two busloads of Armenians who want to see a belly dancer. Do you have a belly dancer? So John says, so I'm jumping into my costume, 120 Armenians come in. It's fantastic. I just happen to have Armenian music in my bag. So we put it on, and what a party we had. It was amazing. It was totally a wonderful sort of an apex experience for me, because they were really into it. And with their own music, it was great. Okay, disasters. Every dancer has disasters. One of my earliest disasters was at a place called Sultan's Table on Denman. Very classy restaurant, top of the line Turkish restaurant. Blue walls, white carpet everywhere, and then white marble all around it. Just over the top, beautiful. So I'm coming in, dancing, and then I feel something on my leg. I always tell my students, don't look down at the dust bunnies, they're not interesting. Look out, see a prince coming over the hill. Dancing. And then I look back, there's these red, bloody footprints on the white carpet. So this thing that I felt on my toe was in fact a broken glass. Oh. And poop, poop, poop. Okay, Liz, get off the carpet, dance on the white marble at least. Always thinking of the restaurant, right? So, dancing on the outskirts, right? On the white marble. Then there was a heart attack. I'm dancing away, and this guy jumps up. He's totally drunk. Jumps up, and then he goes, ha! And falls out. Okay, what do you do? Do I keep the show must go on? What? Okay, what would you do? I don't know how to do CPR. So everybody's there. They move him off. He's the guest of honor. He's got this big throne. He wants to dance with me. So they CPR, they call the emergency guy, they sit him down, anyway, he's kind of groggy. Here I'm getting excited again. So he jumps up again. So I thought, okay, this is how I handle these guys. He jumps up, I sit down. So I sat down, and he realized that he was on his own, so then he sat down too. And that's a good trick. You get some of these pests that want to dance with you too long. You sit down. Let them take the floor, and they realize that, oh, that's no fun. I'm on my own here. Where's the belly dance, right? So that's a good lesson, too. Then another disaster. I got a phone call from the RCMP. They wanted a belly dancer to dance at Chief Archer's. Do you remember Chief Archer? Head of the RCMP. Mm-hmm. At one time. He was retiring. They wanted a belly dancer for his retirement. Oh yeah, fine, no problem. So be here at Hazelmere, blah, blah, blah. At this time I came right at the appointed time. I'm always very careful to come at the appointed time. I don't overbook. They said, you're late. I said, I'm not late. Yes, you're late. So I'm changing and they're banging on the door. You're late. It's psychological, right? You're late. Rattle. I said, what? Yeah, I was totally sort of discombobulated by this time. They rushed me out and they said, go in here. So they pushed me into this box. It's a coffin. So I'm there. I didn't have a chance to think. I'm lying there in the coffin, they slam the lid, but I've got an inch of room, right? Do you know how tight a coffin is? It is really tight. So I'm lying there in my big skirt, you know, and all my coins and things, and I'm lying there, and this lid is right. An itch. And it's all satin and padded. It's comfy. So I feel myself being lifted up and carried in. And then the lid pops open and I'm supposed to jump out. Have you ever tried jumping out when you're like this? Right? You kind of had to go like this and then pull myself up. It was not graceful. Anyway, so I stood up, I thought, okay, do the best I can. So I stood up in this coffin, and then I swirled my skirts until I realized, what the hell am I going to do now? And then I had to go, shh. You know, that's a high thing. And then I step over the side, fine, I dance, and they were happy. So then I got in my car. They paid me handsomely. So they should have. Got into my car and I got the shakes. You know, being in a coffin, you know, I don't know what it was. I was shaking. So the nearest place that I knew was Sanctuary was Cosmos Restaurant, just up the street in White Rock. So I drove up, it wasn't my night to dance there. Drove up, came out to the restaurant. John, the owner, saw me, he says, what's wrong? He saw that. So I told him. So he says, just wait here. He gets his baseball bat. He says, I'm gonna go over there. My dancer like that. I said, John, no! For God's sake, it's the RCMP! So anyway, he settled down. He said, what can I get you? Do you want to spend the night? You know, I've got an apartment. Do you want to drive? I said, no, just give me a brandy. So he gave me a brandy and everything was fine. Then there was the Peeping Tom. This restaurant. Quick, I don't know, I'm not going to say the name. There was something fishy about it, because whenever after you changed and you came out, or just before you came in, the manager was never around. Usually you always see the manager to tell him you're here. And then one of the dancers said, you know, Liz, there's something fishy going on in the grill, because it's always dark. We were always in a special changing room, like kind of a staff room. And there was this grill, it was very dark, but it was an open work grill. She said, you know, I think he's peeping up there. So I never saw him, but when I looked up next, I did see that something, you know, noise up there when you were changing. So we would always, actually, one of the dancers says, I'm just gonna bring an umbrella. Open the umbrella, poke it up there and change under it. And then, I don't know what happened, but maybe he got closed down, but when I came back a few weeks later, it had all been closed over with wood, you know, with plywood. Then, sometimes you can't help it, but you're late, okay? Because the first, I used to have 3 gigs on Friday. The first gig, Major League, you were late all the way down the line, you know? No, you have to wait, the special part is coming in. Yeah, but, you know, I'm supposed to be dancing at 7. Yeah, but wait. So, you know, you're late. So, one time I came late. I think it was the first time I ever came late to the second place. He said, you can dance now, but then you're fired. You came late, half an hour late. So I danced, and then he paid me. And I thought, how am I going to handle this? I thought, okay, I'm just going to rise above it all. I'm going to take my own advice that I give to my students. So I took him by the hand and I said, Costa, thank you for allowing me to dance in this restaurant. I had a wonderful time, and I wish you all the best. You have a great restaurant. Thank you. And I walked it out. Before I got home, Tom says, my husband, he says, there's this guy called Costa who's been phoning. He wants you to come tomorrow. No, okay, you see, he thought about it, and he thought, am I going to let this woman go, or am I going to break her? So, you know, act as though you rise above it all, and it's all good. Other troubles. I was dancing at a Sikh wedding, and I was doing lovely veil work. Wafting around, and this guy grabs the end of the veil and lights it on fire. What do I do, Liz? Quick! Okay, take my own advice. Always good to take your own advice. I took the veil off and I dripped it over the guy. Off I went. So all his friends in a big panic, you know, throwing water all over. I lost a $60 veil. But never mind, he learned his lesson. Dancing in this crowded place, I sometimes dance with a male partner, and so we dance together, and then he goes off there, and I go off there, and then we switch, blah, blah, blah. Shiraz, I don't know whether you've heard of Shiraz, he was my dance partner for many years. Lovely man. Anyway, I'm dancing here, and this table of 4 women, I think, okay, that's good. So this one woman who was sitting right by the aisle, she grabs me and she starts licking my belly. So I said, "Lady, you got the wrong person. Shiraz is over there." She says, "No, it's you I want." Right? So I start my biggest shimmy of all, and I shake her off. I don't know what I'm getting. Anyway, so then another time I was dancing away and I did my big traditional Zagreek, you know, oh, really loud. And there's this Arab sitting there, and he's got all his gear on, right? And he waves his $100 bill, and he kind of sticks it into my belt here, very nice, genteel way. Okay, this is when we were being paid $15 an hour, so $100 away with that. So I finish my dance, I come out, and I didn't like the implication. So I handed him the $100 bill, and I said, "Thank you. You honor me with this much money, but I cannot accept because it's not appropriate," I said. I didn't know how to phrase it. You know, are you propositioning me? What? I didn't want to offend him. He said, "Yes, madam, I understand. So will you have a drink and will you accept 20? I said, "Yes." It's fine. But I didn't like the implication of the 100, and what was I going to do? Maybe extra service? No. So, I found out later through other people's troubles and disasters, never to wear red at an Indian or Sikh wedding, because then you are competing with the bride. Mm-hmm. So you have to decide what kind of wedding it is and wear the appropriate color. You would never wear red at a Sikh wedding, you wouldn't wear white to a Chinese wedding. Is that right? Does anybody know the Chinese, that white is a funeral color?
Yeah.
Okay, so there you go. You never do a sword dance. I mean, sword dance is magnificent. But even if they give you a stage and it's a Sikh wedding, or probably other groups too, you don't do a sword dance at an engagement or a wedding because that cuts the relationship in half. Mm-hmm. And it's considered really bad luck. So anyway, I'm famous for my very colorful ethnic type costumes. Now, one of you bought a big chain, a chain of mine, when you're not here. You did, that's right, you did. So this big chain, I used to wear ones like it. I used to like to attach it to my turban so that the chains would hang down here, and when I did a head slide, it would go like this. It was great, until one time I got stuck with my So, okay, but why do you like taking my own advice? Don't take yourself seriously. So I go. And I went up to, always go to a middle-aged lady that doesn't wear glasses. I walked up to her and she knew what to do. She disentangled me, no problem. So, you know, if I thought it was a disaster, everybody else would have. Mm-hmm. I didn't think it was a disaster. I thought it was funny. So there you go. Don't take yourselves. Then, as a belly dancer, you're going to get improper propositions. How do you handle it? You could go off and be really annoyed, mad, or you could take them up on it, I guess. So I thought, no, my job's too valuable, and my marriage is too great. I don't want to do this, but I still want to keep my job. How do I do this without offending him? So again, don't take yourself too seriously. So I would say, "John, that's a fantastic idea. What a joke. I'm going to tell Tom. He'll also laugh, my husband, right? I'm going to tell Tom what you said." "Oh, no, I didn't mean to do that." "It's just a joke." "Oh, okay, good." Never again, it was adventure. So, okay, classes. I still teach classes. I teach seniors. I used to teach all kinds of people. I used to teach in Kim's very special space called the Sanctuary on Dunbar and 41st. 39. I was dancing at Orestes. I never thought about teaching. I just wanted to dance. And this group of women were sitting together, and they called me over, and they said, "Would you do you teach? I said, no, I can't be bothered. Would you teach? I said, no, I can't be bothered. They said, why? What's wrong? I said, I don't want to go in there and take attendance. I don't want to sweep the floor if necessary. I don't want to call people up if they're sick and not coming. I don't want to take in money. I don't want all that other crap. I just would like to just walk in and teach. So this woman said, fine. We've got just the right person for you. We've got this wonderful floor. And this person, I'm sure, will do all those things for you. And you can just walk in and teach. So that's what I did. Kim, thank you. I taught there for many years. Kim swept the floor, took attendance, got the money, phoned people when they were sick, looked after me when I was upset, celebrated with me when I was happy. She was my soul sister, still is my soul sister. I don't see her enough as I ought to, but we've got this fantastic connection, and thank you, Kim. See, now I'm getting old.
Thank you,
The big highlight of, I've only got 7 minutes. Big highlight of Annie Bailey Dance career is the New Year's Eve party. And I used to have 5 or 6 gigs, and I could never get there on time, right, to all of them, right, all around midnight. Some of them were sort of 10 o'clock and others were at 1. So I just hired me a race car driver. Mm-hmm. And he would pull up, I would jump out in my costume, dance, he would be there waiting, jump in, he'd be I could do 5 gigs a night. Okay, this is what I teach my students. It's called performance strategies, hard won by me. You're dancing away in a restaurant, you see a couple, at least this is what I do. I'm not telling you to do it, but this is what I have learned. A couple. I smile at the woman and kind of waft by quickly. You don't know what they're doing. Could be a first date. You don't want to threaten them. You don't want to threaten the woman. There you are, shaking your booty. You don't want to do that. They could be discussing a divorce, which is you really don't want to do that. I don't know what they're discussing. Couples are dynamite. They are deadly. Okay? So you kind of stay away from couples. 4 to 6 people are great. 3 couples, they've got things going, they're relaxed, you can fool around with them, you can do it their best. 4 to 6 women on their own are perfect. They know what you're trying to do, they're with you. And they're the most fun of all. Singles, men or women, I go by and smile weakly and leave them alone unless they make special eye contact and want me to come closer. You get the pest. The pest who grabs you or wants to dance and won't let you go. So, he's dancing too long, I sit down, and as soon as he sees that he's on his own, he also will leave. Also, if you're friends with the head waiter or any waiter, they know, they will look after you. And if he's a pest, you can go. And they will. Disabled people, I always pay very special attention to anybody who's disabled, either mentally or physically. I'll make sure to go up to them, be very gentle, make good eye contact beforehand. Never put a veil on because you don't know whether they're going to be claustrophobic, but I do make good eye contact and I come up slowly and I just touch them on the shoulder to pay special attention. And they just blossom. They just love it. Any disabled person just, you know, because they're invisible. Usually in the public eye, disabled people are invisible. So you have honored them by making them visible, and they just love it. Major tips. So the other thing is, when you're looking for a job, you come looking for an interview the first time you come and say you want a job at the restaurant. Come looking like a belly dancer. You don't have to have a costume on. You have to have major makeup on and something flashy, okay? Because I have sent wonderful dancers to restaurants to take my place. Sometimes I can't do it, and I say I'm sending a substitute. They usually are quite happy with that, except that one time I sent this woman. It was raining, and she had a bicycle. She didn't have a car, but she lived very close. So she came in dressed like in the rain, right? She came in. And she had her costume and makeup and everything. And she came early enough that she could just get dressed up. The manager took one look at her and said, no, go home. Because you don't look like a belly dancer. He said, Tisha, you don't look like a belly dancer. How can you dance like one? Go home. Okay, so, good lesson. Come looking like you're ready to dance right now. So, first impressions are really important. I've had a long career. It's been great. I paid the mortgage off with my dancing money, which is no mean feat. I routinely had 3 jobs on Friday and 2 on Saturday, and then 1 on Wednesday at Orestes, and 1, which didn't last long, on Monday night at 1 o'clock. Like, no way, I have to get up the next morning and work at SFU. So that one lasted about 6 weeks. But they paid well. Never mind, I gave that one up. So I had six jobs throughout the week, and gradually the pay rate went up, and yeah, it was good, it was really good. So, questions? Yes?
How did your husband react?
He loved it. Mm-hmm. He's the one that pushed me through the door in the first place.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Yeah, and the thing is that he would be very proud, and he'd say to his family, well, his brother, for one, he'd say, you know, there's this belly dancing in this place. And his brother would say, you let her, you allow her to do that? So, you know, bug off. I've always wanted to do my own thing. I've been a lot, thank you a lot, Tom. He's always allowed me and encouraged me to do my own thing. Now I'm an artist. I have shows, and I wish I'd brought my list. I could have asked you to sign up for an invitation to my next show. It's a solo show of, it's called Spirit Hunters, and it's about shamanism. It's a show of shamanism. I make robes, shamanic robes, and I paint shamanic images, and it's gonna be all on in this gallery in Newton. Anyway, never mind. You can email me and I then will send you an invitation, but I promise not to email you for any other reason. Anybody else? Questions?
Yes.
Comments? Yeah.
When you came to Egypt, your very first costume that you bought in the lovely place under the green door, how much did you pay for it?
$100 US. But it had everything. It had the belt, the bra, the headdress, the deck piece, and 2 gauntlets. It was complete. It's really nice. Yeah. Obviously, I dance like an angel. Anybody else? Yes.
So how many more Madame Abbas?
That was it.
You only went for one.
Yeah. Because I usually make my own.
Yeah.
Because I love ethnic. This was a really hardcore cabaret costume.
Yes.
Everybody else. Every other costume, because they're very personal. Everybody else. Every other costume was ethnic. Lots of drapery. Lots of things driving upon you. Yes.
What was your favorite music? Was it Turkish, Egyptian? Where from?
Armenian.
Oh.
It has a nice beat. It's generally quite romantic, and it's playful. Okay. Well,
did you tell the story about the pasture? The cow.
No, you were going to tell it.
Okay, I'm going to tell you the story.
I do remember.
So this is over 20 years ago. Yes, over 20 years ago, because my son is now almost 20. And we were dancing as a group called Nur El Dunya, which means light of the world. And we were asked to perform somewhere in some place in the country that required us to perform in a barn. And there was a cow pasture. Right, attached to the barn. And we were, you know, kind of city slickers and things like this. And so we were trying to suss out our entrance. So Elizabeth says, and you know, it's 5 of us or so, and we're all on our cover-ups. And Elizabeth says, well, we could probably go under that fence right there. You know, these wired fences. And one of our smarter troop members who has some sense of, you know, the country said, that's a cow fence. That, you know, has an electric. That'd be a great entrance. And we said, well, we can't do that. And Elizabeth's response, and this was it, she said, oh, it's just a little shock. Needless to say, we did not enter through that one. Because there was cow crap everywhere. Right? But I will never forget that moment, just standing in the middle of the field with you going, it's just a little shock. I would have followed you. You know I'd follow you anywhere.
I thought for a minute and I went,
it's probably not that little.
Cows are kind of big.
I forgot about that.
Yep, better get a corn.